Hi, I'm Jon Favreau, director of Disney's 2019 version of The Lion King. Everything you're about to see was created by digital artists, whether it's the animated performances of the lions or the environments that were built. Every branch, every tree, every rock. And we were able to create something that hopefully will look to you to be photoreal. There is, however, one shot that we included that we filmed during one of our research trips in Africa. We put it in there as a bit of a Easter egg and a surprise for people seeing it in the theaters, but now that it's on home video, we could reveal the secret to you. The real shot is the very first shot, the sun rising up during Circle of Life. Everything else you see is completely digital. It's a film that I connected with because of its story and because of the music. And we're very lucky to assemble a lot of the same people who were involved with the original film. Of course, we have a new wonderful cast, but we have all the classic moments and classic songs from the film that you grew up with. So sit back, relax, and enjoy The Lion King.
From that day we arrive on the planet and blinking step into the sun, there's more to see than can ever be seen, more to do than can ever be done. There's far too much to take in here, more to find than can ever be found. By the sun rolling high through the sapphire sky, keeps great and small on the endless round. It's the circle of life, and it moves us all through despair. Through faith and love, till we find our place on the path unwinding in the circle of life. It's the circle of life, and it moves us all through despair and hope, through faith and love, till we find a place on an island wide.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. It ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's our problem-free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata?
Yeah, it's our motto.
What's a motto?
Nothing. What's a motto with you?
Nice!
Boom!
Those two words will solve all your problems.
Yeah. Take Pumbaa here. Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog!
How you feeling?
It's an emotional story.
He found his aroma lacked a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul. Although I seem thick-skinned.
And it hurt that my friends never stood downwind.
I was always here for you, and I resent that.
Oh, the shame!
Yes, he was ashamed!
I thought of changing my name.
I mean, to what, Brad?
And I got downhearted. Every time that I farted, are you gonna stop me?
No, I'm not. You disgust me. Hakuna Matata, what a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata, ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
Yeah, sing it, kid.
It's a problem-free philosophy.
Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna.
It means no worries for the rest of your days.
It's a problem-free philosophy.
Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna
Matata, Hakuna
Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata,
Hakuna Matata.
Simba, you speak bird.
Married! Come on, one day you will be married! To each other!
Ew! Mm-mm. That's not gonna happen, Zazzy.
Never, ever.
Nala and I are friends. And besides, she's afraid of rhinos.
And he's never eaten an impala.
I tried it once.
We are never getting married, Zazu.
A monarch who ignores tradition. With an attitude like that, I'm afraid you'll be a pretty pathetic king.
Well, I'm not letting anyone tell me where to go, what to do, and even who to marry. There will never be a king like me.
Simba, you can't escape your destiny.
Just watch. I'm gonna be a mighty king, so enemies beware.
Well, I've never seen a king of beasts with quite so little hair.
I'm gonna be the main event, like no king was before. I'm brushing up on looking down, working on my roar.
Oh, thus far, a rather uninspiring thing.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
You have rather a long way to go, young master, if you think...
No one's saying do this.
Now, when I said that...
No one's saying be there.
What I meant
was... No one's
was...
saying stop that. No one says see here.
Now see here.
Free to run around all day.
Well, that's definitely out.
Free to do it all my way.
I think it's time that you and I arranged a heart-to-heart.
Kings don't need advice from little hornbills for a start.
If this is where the monarchy is headed, count me out. Out of service, out of Africa, I wouldn't hang about. This child is getting wildly out of wing. Simba.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
I can't see you, Simba. You must be in my sight at all times. I've lost him. I know what you're doing. Where are you going, Simba? Come off! You can't hide from me, Simba. It is my sworn duty to keep you safe. You listen to me right now! I'm sorry to flutter about in your face. Have you seen? He's a little lion. He's small, but he's cute.
Everybody look left. Everybody look right. Everywhere you look, I'm standing in the spotlight.
Not yet.
Let every creature go for broken.
I see you
it's
down there!
Making Simba's finest fling. Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
Simba!
Oh, he just can't wait to be king. Oh, I just can't wait. He just can't wait to be king.
Get out of my way! Get out there! I've lost him! Mufasa's is gonna have my presence! This is not good!
Part of the fun of filmmaking is the innovation and pushing things technically and figuring out how to use new tools and then also creating tools that don't exist to help tell a story.
We could tilt the ground plane a certain number of degrees, right? Because it's one thing we could grab. Could we also move Simba's animation and tilt Simba's animation as well?
But the buffalo won't.
Well, here's the next thing. Why don't we tilt the buffalo too? They may not be cresting properly, but they'll follow the terrain.
And now we had available to us a technology that could actually present these characters as if they were real living animals. And for me, that's a challenge, but it's a fun challenge. It's like a puzzle.
John and the team, they really pushed the envelope on the Jungle Book. But even the envelope that they're pushing then is very different from what we're doing now. And we've been able to find some ways of making it even better to be able to tell this story. Since we don't have a human character, we're only dealing with animals, and we need to deal with it in a photorealistic way.
Well, look at this.
Roll sound.
What we did on Jungle Book is we had people in their traditional ADR recording sessions, and that was great. But what you find is that they just have their script, and they tend to look down at their script and look back up at the monitor and look down at their script. John came up with this concept of having actors actually interact in a volume. So he called it Black Box Theater, which is essentially a big black room with six reference cameras, people as invisible as possible so the actors can really feel like they're by themselves and actually engaging. And that way you get winks, looks, distance. You know, we had a hard time in ADR with people not understanding that they need to shout or whisper. It's much easier when you have the people to bounce off of.
Start with complete freedom, and if I need to make adjustments to limit movement or something,
sure.
We'll figure out what's what. We'll do that as we go on.
I was trying to pursue an approach that made this film feel less like an animated movie, more like a live-action film. And not just a live-action film, but a live-action film in the way that I'm used to photographing it.
Did you hear that? The future king!
Do it again.
Do it again, yeah. Oh, guys, everybody, whoa, hold on.
I like when there's some naturalism. I like when there's some discovery. I think that spark helps make it feel real.
This feels good. Yeah. This is us.
Yeah, I like this. This is wonderful. Much better.
Especially with the hyenas, we wanted to get their performance together as much as possible.
Hyenas and lions have been at war since the beginning of time. But Mufasa's bloodline ends here.
I tried to get all my information from the script. So I went through it and I got little hints, like Shenzi has a few lines where you can get an idea, okay, people respect her. She's somebody, people are scared of her. She enters a room and everybody's quiet.
Jon Favreau and I were discussing how the character's gonna work and how you're gonna interact with the other hyenas. And then he started playing back some of the sound that Florence had provided.
I'm the queen of the rock.
And I'm like, oh, no, I got it. I got it. I'm scared of her.
that was fun because then we could also be physical and we could walk around and we can look at each other and you could try out different things.
Especially compared to like kind of regular animation voiceover where you're just standing in front of a microphone. This gives you the freedom to really get it in your body. It's nice to be more physical.
You and I are not going down there. Neither of us are going down there.
Oh, okay.
Okay, neither of us are going down there.
Yes.
Right?
Okay.
We both agree
okay.
that Simba's dead.
Well, we can't be for sure.
Simba is dead. That's all she ever has to know.
Works for me.
What's nice about this is the whole process is iterative. So we'll start with script pages and drawings, keyframe art, just for moments of the production.
We're still all drawing on, drawing generally, you know, on an interactive tablet with a stylus pen, and that's the way everybody storyboards nowadays. And it's an all digital workflow for us that goes from digital drawing into the animatic. That's our limited animation in the animatic, and music and song and dialogue all sort of work together and work in that workflow for us.
Once we see that a sequence is working and moving right, then we transition over to building the environments digitally and creating them so that we can explore them in virtual reality.
There's a big wad of fog or something that's catching in that valley.
It's been interesting learning about that. I mean, I think I've always designed digitally, so in a lot of ways, it fits perfectly with the way we've been operating up to this point. But I definitely feel like the advances in the technology and VR have brought a whole new tool set that has really expanded our capability.
This does feel like the beginning of the journey up in a cool way.
I feel like the idea of actually designing the whole world from scratch is definitely, for me, the biggest leap. I mean, I'm used to being able to incorporate real location and our set builds, and so to realize that like it all comes down to us, there will be no location, there will be no location augmentation or anything like that, has been new and thrilling, honestly.
This is gonna have every asset below the set. So if you say, I need a branch here, he's gonna fly under there, get the branch and bring it up.
So that's like your truck.
Yeah.
We've got a team of incredible illustrators that are able to render up an idea, a vision of the world really quickly at a high level of resolution. And then it's sort of like going back to building blocks inside the computer where you just rough in the terrain and then slowly, slowly that keeps shaping and adding elements and dressing. And then beyond that, it's like another infinite pool of detail that needs to be added to it. We're doing this 100-mile radius circle of open vista landscape with grass and trees and rocks. It's actually the most, you know, data crunching sort of thing that we could ask the computer to do. So it's been our goal from the beginning that you could fly freely around the savannah from Pride Rock to Rafiki's tree to the watering hole to the elephant graveyard, all the way to the cloud forest in continuum. And we have achieved that.
The art department is building all these different environments, and they're building about 100 different species of plants.
It's just staggering, the amount of detail. Every rock, every pebble, every little weed. You know, they've developed simulations that can grow grass at different heights and, you know, simulate the way the water would erode certain surfaces. It's mind-boggling how much detail's needed to create a world that feels real.
Welcome to our humble home.
I think people of my generation who grew up with video games are very sensitive to photography and shots that look like they're completely digital. And so the trick is, how do you make it look like it was really filmed? And the way shots are designed when they're digital are much more efficiently done. The camera move is designed ahead of time, the cut points, the edit points, the performance, the camera moves. All that stuff is meticulous and perfect. But that perfection leads to a feeling that it's artificial.
Nature movies, you're used to seeing it from a distance, but reading so much emotion to it. You don't see a close-up of a baby elephant going up to the other elephant. You know, you see it from a distance always, and yet it's heartbreaking. So how can we plug into that?
When we thought, how are we going to approach The Lion King, we knew we needed to do something new, completely new. And we had the idea to do this in virtual reality, take the tools of virtual reality and apply those to filmmaking in a way that's never been done before. We built a video game, the purpose of which is to make a movie. Inside that video game, instead of cars and guns and points being scored, we've got cameras and lights and lions. So we go inside the volume, which is this technology blank space, this space that's filled with grids that hold virtual reality sensors, things that tell the computers where virtual cameras are in space, or virtual steadicams, or virtual dollies, or virtual cranes. These all look like and feel like real filmmaking equipment, except there's no camera attached. There's just a sensor that says, hi, I'm a camera, I'm over here, I've got a 50 millimeter lens on, I'm looking downward at 20 degrees, and there's a line. And it's just as if you're playing a video game, except instead of controllers, and we do use controllers at times, we're using tripods, we're using wheels, we're using steadicams. So we're giving the filmmakers all the analog tools that they're accustomed to. Their instincts are reliable, but the output is all through this real-time game engine.
Yeah, let's just back up the animation. You need to be a hair lower, though.
All right.
There you go. Let's do it right there.
You can't do anything to me. Because I'm the future king.
So we're doing it the opposite of the way anybody that I know has done it, which is we're putting all of our work into capturing the camera data and making the camera data feel like it's being driven by humans. You inherit all of the idiosyncrasies of practical photography.
Almost every movie you've ever loved, there's some shot in there that you like that was an accident. That is like a great shot. That is like, wow, how'd you come up with that? I wish I knew. The computer eliminates that. The computer just nulls all that out. It's just now single frame. Where do you like this frame? Yeah, okay. And then how about 4 seconds later, you like that frame? It's like, maybe, yeah. And then you string it together and it's like, yeah, it's sort of like a shot, but it's not the same as grabbing a camera and looking through it and then responding to what you're seeing.
John?
Yeah?
Suggestion is start up a little bit higher and then come down.
Okay.
So you see into the canyon a little bit.
Okay.
3, 2, 1, go. That was kind of cool.
Yeah, I chased him down.
Sevens up. You know what's great about it is that every shot is different, but is still really good.
VR is actually giving us the experience of being in the set. So basically, you put on VR, you go to Africa, you're in Africa, and you're on the plains of Africa, and you have animated characters that walk through there. And the way you would on a regular movie, you say, well, to see what I want to see, I want to be here, and then if I dolly over here, when they walk over there, I'll be on their faces so I can see them looking out over the savanna. And so you say, okay, let's lay a dolly track from here to there. And then, you know, you then take the VR headset off and you go and you have a monitor that is what the camera would see. And you say, okay, let's try this. And, you know, the dolly grip goes, no, go a little bit faster because I missed seeing him turn his head or whatever it is. And then, so you're really making it as if you're making a regular movie.
So this is all great in the beginning. And I don't mind, it's nice when he starts to sing to be on Timon, that's really great. And this is all okay. This is great, because you got both of them.
I got through some veggies there.
Now here's the problem.
Yeah.
Because this is his solo, so you really want to be around here and get him on this. You know, so you want to be, now you're good, that's fine.
Near the village, the peaceful village, the lion sleeps tonight.
Those surprises and those accidents that oftentimes, you know, will impose themselves on a movie and make it better than what you imagine. So we're trying to create an imperfect world in which little things can happen that will create the kind of surprise that we're used to in live filming.
It's gonna be great.
Yeah.
It's gonna be great.
Okay.
okay. Let's do that.
Slating stones, 32 tick, one is up, stand by.
We're having to do
this. Am I both in nav?
They should both be nav controllers, yes. Okay.
It took a couple of days for everybody to get comfortable with virtual reality. And as a matter of fact, it's very disconcerting at first because people get really weirded out by it because their brains kind of panic. You know, some people have nausea when they get into VR for the first time. Your body goes, hang on a second. I'm seeing stuff that makes me think it should be real, but it's not quite doing what I think it should be doing. So maybe there's a problem with me. After a certain amount of time, users bodies adapt and realize there's not a problem with them, they're okay. So you have to get people over this initial curve, which is the first time they go in, they might get woozy, they might get nauseous, but they build up a tolerance to it and their body just says, we're fine, that's not important, just keep going, it's okay. So the more you use the stuff, the more adapted you become to it. And it's very much like a muscle.
Are you flying or are you static over
there? I'm flying. This is me. Who are you?
I like to walk around on a location scout in a real environment and say, wow, where's the sun coming? So the sun's gonna be there? That's a nice background, so we should probably shoot the... So which side should they be? I guess they come in from here? You know, and so you're talking with other people and your production designer saying, I picked this location because I like that background. And the cinematographer will say, well, we should shoot this before lunch, we should shoot this part of the scene, and after lunch, this part of the scene. We have those conversations when you have like five of us in our VR sets scouting, and we're all together. I'm like, oh, is this a nice shot? Caleb, come over here. What do you think of this? Oh, I like this. Oh, but how about that? So by walking around together, and also with VR, because we're getting used to flying around together, we're finding shots and locations.
This is nice up here too. I don't know what this is for, but come up here, guys, see where I am. I'm zapping everybody.
And we are looking back
towards the desert.
Okay.
There's a...
Yeah, that's nice. Because there, I like the height.
Yeah, I like this. This is great. And even if you go up high and look down at them there, it's kind of cool. Because you get that whole valley behind.
Where are you? You're green?
I'm just up to the right of where the flag is.
You're green. Okay.
If you're looking back towards the...
Yes, and would you include the horizon in your framing too?
Part of the most fun to me is seeing Caleb Deschanel really embracing this set of tools and coming up with shots and techniques and things that I never even thought we'd be doing and surprising me with these inspired moments while still incorporating all of the elegance in his lighting and framing, which is the reason that I hired him and been a fan.
If somebody had asked me, you know, 5 years ago, would you be working on a film at the cutting edge of film technology, I would say, are you crazy? I mean, but I actually find it much more agreeable than I thought from the point of view that it is very similar to what I'm used to doing. I mean, I find myself making the same kind of, you know, decisions in the same way and the same eye towards telling a story.
I think I can get away with just this. It's the only thing that I'm bothered by is that this is a little hot here.
Yeah. Well, honestly, you want to move the rock? You want to get the rock out of there? I don't think that rock was there.
Why don't we just lose that rock?
Then
everything will be great.
I mean, the one thing that's really difficult about this is that because you have the tools to do anything you want, I mean, you can put the sun in one place and we can have, you know, any kind of atmosphere and you can pick the skies that you like and everything, is that you also want to build in to this the same kind of restrictions that you would have when you made a live movie.
We can get, you know, times where they cross and then we come into a close-up over.
Yeah.
And then the same thing on the other side.
Now you have a much further evolved scene before it even gets animated.
Having the unevenness sort of play into it,
yeah,
that's great.
Bringing these characters to life in a very believable, realistic way and make people kind of scratch their heads and wonder what they're looking at, that's kind of the most fun of all. In terms of what we're reaching, in terms of level of performance and level of detail in these characters in terms of skin movement and muscle, you know, it's pushing it all to that next level.
Luckily, MPC, who is the vendor that's doing all the work for all the characters and, well, basically for every shot in the film, they've been a really good partner with us.
It's a bit of a tricky shot because in reality, the camera probably wouldn't be traveling. I mean, the camera's not going as fast as the bird, but the bird would probably be traveling a little bit faster. So Zaza would be going quicker here, and if the animals are scrolling by faster, does it somehow break the? He's trying to talk to them. He's saying, "I'm sorry to bother you, but have you seen the little guy? You know, if he's flying by them a little quicker, is that going to bother you?" It'll definitely feel more real if I could speed up Zazie.
I think this is one of the shots we're going to show our hand. So whatever we could do to make it feel more like a documentary footage would be better.
We get animation approved on a very rudimentary scale, and then it goes to the VR stage for being shot, and then it goes to editorial. They cut it together like live action footage. From there, it goes from kind of a previs animation, we go into final animation. And we have different rigs involved. We get into all the details of performance and nitpicking things, and then there might be slight changes, especially with physics and the way, you know, these animals move or where they tackle each other, like the cubs. You really get into the details of the weight and the timings and how that's gonna look.
I think you want a rock she can get up on that you could go over to, and then you see all the lions behind her, and they all the lionesses sort of step up, and you could tell that they'll follow her. And then that roar kind of caps it. So now you've really stacked up you've moved all the troops into place.
Are you with me, lions?
We're trying to build a moment here.
The collaboration of humans is the most important part of this incredibly technical and technological film. And I think that's often lost, that the people who are most often drawn to technology are people who are first and foremost concerned with pushing the limits of tech. But in our case, we want to use this technology to further humanize the storytelling. You're taking an incredibly antiseptic digital medium and telling one of the most emotional stories that we have in our tradition using these tools. And to me, that dichotomy, that underlying tension creates a lot of creative opportunity. And also, it's a high wire act, so there's a sense that we really have to give it our all, because this is an experiment. It's a big experiment overall. But I think that that urgency and that sense of that if we do something really cool here, we can be affecting the way people make movies moving forward, is very exciting.
Simba, it's so beautiful.
Morning, everybody. Hey. I have a couple of questions for you. Who of you has seen The Lion King? Hands up. Good. This is a good thing. So I thought we could improve on it this time. Just a little bit.
This is a reinterpretation of the original Lion King. I think half of what people remember from that movie is the music.
No one anticipated that this would actually have songs. And in fact, there was enormous resistance. It took almost a year to really fully embrace the idea of that music.
It's the serpent line.
Zimmer, who's just the most amazing composer, did the original, of course, along with Elton John. And we brought in Hans Zimmer again to bring his music to the highest reality, the highest level of production value possible.
This time around, I had 102 people in the room with the orchestra and the percussionist and the band and everybody else. We had a choir in Los Angeles, we had a choir in South Africa, which was at least 40 people. If the first one was myself and Lebo and a small, tiny village, this one was Lebo, myself, and a whole city.
I just think Circle of Life is the song that really makes the film. It was a mixture of African music and pop music, and that hadn't really happened before.
On the original movie, I always had this idea that wouldn't it be great to start a Disney movie with a voice of Africa? My brief originally was it was supposed to be sort of 30 seconds of music, and then it was going to be this big dialogue scene. And I had done the whole Elton Circle of Life thing and tried to sort of make it African. And Robin Roger, the directors, came in, Don Hahn, and I played them the thing, and they had this sort of whispered conversation after hanging, and I thought, great, I'm fired, you know, because I obviously didn't stick to the brief. And I said, okay, guys, look, I can go and do what you actually asked me to do. And they said, no, we just want to go and redesign the whole opening of the movie. And you know, it ends with that big drum hitting, boom, you know. It's only now when we were working on it that I figured out why the big drum. Again, it was because they were coming at 6 o'clock and I hadn't finished the arrangement. And I just needed to end it somehow. So I just put this big drum hit in the middle of like nowhere. And it sort of became an iconic part of it.
Watch this.
JD, who's playing young Simba, he's great. He was somebody that we found through the casting process. And it just so happens that he was, in addition to being a bit of a YouTube sensation as a singer, he collaborated with Donald Glover on the last Childish Gambino album. Having him play the young Donald and hearing them both sing is wonderful. I think he brings not just humanity to the role, but his so much personality in the way he sings it. And it's nice to have the opportunity to have actors who are both the performers and the singers.
I'm gonna be a mighty king, so enemies beware.
It was just crazy getting such an iconic role.
Simba.
Just to be a part of this is a real pleasure.
We heard a lot of actors read for the role, and when we saw him, we're like, all right, that's it. That's the kid. And Shahadi Wright as well.
She actually was in the production playing young Nala of a stage production of Lion King. There was very little discussion. It was hers from the beginning.
Pinja.
And maybe a little more aggressively.
Pinja.
I started watching the movie when I was about maybe 5 or 6, but I definitely love seeing it, and I definitely want there to be a lot of inspiration in the characters, the same as in the original movie.
I had a voice.
Yeah, flat. I know. Can we go in for the last wait?
Oh, I just can't wait to be.
Maybe come into it, hit your run going up, ascending. When you come back down, land on the note. But I would say like 25% is where you should be right back in.
It's crazy. Pharrell just helping me sing. It'd be like if you couldn't ice skate for a movie and they're like, don't worry, Wayne Gretzky will be helping you.
I'm sitting next to one of the great magicians who knows, you know, he can go up to an actor who's never sung before and pull something out of the hat that makes this person comfortable and makes this person perform and makes this person find the truth.
One and a two and a Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata. It ain't no passing craze.
It's not a traditional sound, but you bring so much meaning to the lyric.
I almost nailed it.
Having Billy and Seth, that was fun.
What?
They know each other and they have mutual respect, similar sensibilities.
We're a really good mix, I think. It's like a good yin and yang.
I was a huge fan of the original movie. I like grew up with it. I've seen it so many times. So it's a little hard at first to kind of separate yourself from it and to just not organically do the thing that the other person's doing.
Hakuna Matata, what a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata.
I think it's different enough that it became pretty clear pretty early that there would be ways to create a new dynamic between the characters.
My favorite parts about the original movie was Timon and Pumbaa, so it really is an honor to get to sort of do my spin on it. It's definitely a moving story. It's not just this big, splashy, comedic, animated musical. There's a lot of emotion in it, a lot of levels to it, and you know, I, along with Seth, get to be sort of the comic presence, the most bold comic presence of the movie. It's incredible to be a part of it.
Repeat after me. Hakuna Matata.
Did you hear?
hear that? I said Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata. You're gonna hear it 12 more times.
I'd say like closer to 30.
People really love Hakuna Matata, and Hakuna Matata as a phrase has stayed with us for the decade since the original Lion King. That's part of the cultural lexicon. So on the one hand, you don't want to mess with it too much. At the same time, we're throwing in some jokes here and there. We want to put our spin on it.
Do you want to do something different, Seth, with the downwind thing that leads into it?
Yeah.
He found his aroma lacked a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, although I seem thick-skinned. But it hurt that my friends never stood downwind. And oh, the shame!
He was a shame!
Here come the floodgates! I thought of changing my name!
That's very complicated.
It's a hard process.
Point.
It's a very hard process. And I got downhearted every time that I farted. You were supposed to stop me.
Why?
Because kids can't hear that word.
Kids can't hear farted.
I didn't know if all the songs from the original were gonna be in this, but then they told me that they were, and I was like, I can't sing, but I try really hard, and I have a lot of hours to dedicate to this, so I'll just do what, I'll just do my best.
This is already the most embarrassing experience.
I want them to count how many times I've tried to record that one line, it ain't no passing craze, because I bet it's in the thousands.
Ain't no passing craze.
It ain't no passing.
No passing craze. Craze.
We should get to Donald's part at some point.
No, I just like listening and...
It was just really fun. Pretty much just us cracking jokes on each other and looking at each other. We're all like in a triangle, you know, sitting there. So like we're all in the room just looking, and there's cameras and stuff like that. So like any mess ups were just met with laughter.
I thought that was pretty good.
I clicked into place. It was one of those things that clicked in.
Well, there's a lot more improv. No one's really afraid to, because everybody knows the script already.
Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna Matata, Hakuna.
It means no worries. It's our problem.
Having Donald Glover, who's an amazing singer, also amazing improviser, which is one of the things that really drew me to him, because he comes from a very common comedic background that I do. I knew that we would have a common take on how to do that type of performance.
Oh, I gotcha. Oh man, did you see that?
A guy having talents in all those areas, I thought was gonna bring a lot of dynamism to the part and just charm.
Yay.
When I first heard John was doing it, I was very excited because I really liked the Jungle Book adaptation he did. And he was like, hey, I don't know if you heard, but I'm making The Lion King. And I was like, oh, yeah. I said, congratulations. He's like, do you want to be Simba? Like, it was like that.
Simba? Is that really you?
Yeah. It's me, Simba.
I never hesitated for a moment. I guess the only... thing really scary is singing with Beyonce.
Can you feel the love?
That's the only part where I'm like, y'all sure y'all want me to do this?
The peace the evening brings.
I am still in shock that I'm a part of this, because I grew up loving The Lion King. It's the first Disney movie that brought me to tears.
When you think of somebody who you'd be excited to hear reinterpret this role, especially the musical performances. She's sort of in a class all by herself. Having Beyonce in my film definitely bought me a lot of credibility with my kids and their friends.
There's about four songs in the film from the original. Hakuna Matata, Circle of Life, Can You Feel the Love Tonight, and I Just Can't Wait to Be King. And they wanted a song for the end. The end of the film is gonna be uplifted, so we went and wrote Never Too Late.
It's never too late to turn.
That's a brand new song, but it definitely feels connected to the tradition, and we're using people that are associated with the movie. Tim Rice wrote and Elton John performed, and Lebo M brought a choir, South African choir.
Hello.
Hi, Lebo.
It's lovely to get the opportunity to write another song for the movie. This is part of our life. It's a huge part of Tim and I's life. So it's just wonderful to be associated with something that's given so many people so much pleasure. It's never too late to change. And that's what Simba goes through in this whole journey. This is about having an epiphany in your life and saying, I need to take a fresh look at what I'm doing. I'm not doing the right thing. I'm going to do the right thing for my family, for myself, and for all the animals involved in the jungle. It sends a message that we all need to hear at the moment. You can change and you can be good.
I think the message of it is so wonderful and life-affirming, and I think that there's layers and layers of themes to it that are so relevant today as much as they were when the film was first conceived.
I thought that was really good. Everybody, thank you so much for being the most human, wonderful element that you can possibly have. Because at the end of the day, what we do, telling stories in our language of music, is unbelievably powerful. Thank you, John.
One day, Simba, the sun will set on my time here and will rise with you as the new king.
I remember I was in Africa on safari, and when a warthog ran by the safari vehicle, one of the people started singing Hakuna Matata. And then when we saw the lions up on a rock, they all said, oh, look, it looks like Lion King. It's become the frame of reference that everybody knows and accepts. And since I've been involved, I noticed how it pops up in comedy routines, in music, on TV shows, as part of sketches. It's constantly being referenced. And so it's such a deep part of our culture.
I knew the film would be successful, but nobody had an idea of how successful this story would be. You get something from it every time.
I actually feel a great bit of responsibility because I just know how much it meant to me. I really know this movie so well. I think me and my brother and sister probably watched it every Saturday for like at least a year.
It's got all this Shakespearean sort of relevance to it. It's got these songs that are so amazingly catchy, but you're not worried about, you know, humming them all day. You kind of enjoy it going round and round in your head. It was a full experience. It was like nothing else, really. And then the musical afterwards, the whole kind of spectacle and sense of it was so full.
I purposely have not gone back to watch the movie. I did go see the Broadway show recently with John. He was in New York and invited me. What was I gonna do, say no?
John was really inspired when he saw the Lion King play. And he saw that these two things that were of the same DNA could live and be seen as different things. And that made him believe that he could see the Lion King made digitally and still honor the animated film.
As the world has changed, as technology has changed, so has the Lion King.
Everything you see exists together in a delicate balance. As king, you need to understand that balance and respect all the creatures.
We are all connected in the great circle of life.
Lion King, I felt I could really do something special with, because I understood how important that inherited relationship with the material and the characters was. It has such powerful themes and such timeless themes. Not musical themes, that as well, but I mean themes, emotional themes and themes that predate the film, going back to Hamlet and before, when you're dealing with all of the betrayal and the coming of age and death and rebirth and all of the cycles of life that are the foundation of all the myths around the world. There was such a rich tradition surrounding this material.
John's, I think, very sensitive to that, and he's careful to honor the story and honor the film and make the fans happy, all sort of in service of telling this wonderful story.
The original film, nobody knew was coming. It wasn't a high-profile project at the time. And the first trailer Disney put out, there was a title card that said that Disney's next movie is going to be The Lion King. Here's the opening song.
The very first trailer of The Lion King was just Circle of Life played straight through, partly because it's all we had finished in animation and we had to have something to put in the movie theaters. But the surprise to us was how emotional people got about it.
I remember going to see Beauty and the Beast. My parents took me and my sister before they showed the Lion King trailer. And it was like one of the most pivotal moments in my life. Like, honestly, because it was no words, just music, and you're seeing all this stuff. You didn't know anybody, you didn't know any of these characters. And then that Lion King at the end, people were just gasping in the theater. It was really great.
You know, the first thing I asked when I got hired was, when's D23? Because the D23 Expo is when the Disney fans, and not just the Disney fans, but you also have the Star Wars fans and the Marvel fans, Pixar fans, all gathered to one place. It's much like Comic-Con in that you have this hall with, I think, 5,000 or 6,000 people in it, and you're presenting to them, you're making a case for the slate of upcoming productions. And the best is when you get to give a sneak peek and sort of show the people who are the most invested in this property what you're planning to do with it.
We're working hard. We love you guys, and we love this movie, and thank you so much for the opportunity.
And so I found out that the expo was going to be in, I think, less than 6 months. And so we scrambled, and we got together to see if it was even possible. We didn't want to make it too ambitious so that we couldn't execute it properly. The appeal was the opportunity to present this film the way that the original film was presented. So we set out to make our version of The Circle of Life. We couldn't do the full song, but I wanted the experience of the 2 minutes we could achieve to make you feel like you saw the whole number. So we scrambled to design young Simba, Rafiki. We figured we could film around other elements of it pretty well because it was 2 years away and nobody really expected us to have anything this close to finished. As soon as the sun rose and we heard the opening notes, I felt the whole room get drawn in. And then as people saw the images and realized that we were really trying to do our best to represent the old film, and with each successive image, the reaction grew in the crowd. And the momentum that you get from that enthusiasm of a very knowledgeable and invested crowd that is very fast to say whether they like or don't like what you're doing, when they approve of what you're doing and they cheer for it, you bring that energy back into the workshop.
So I think that the shot maybe wants to be a little bit coming from further away. I feel like it's too short of a move. Yeah. So it should be a longer move that ends with the surprise of his face dropping down. Then I think the composition's great for the end frame.
Come.
We always keep the old film loaded up. So as we're looking at our story department, looking at animatics, looking at sequences, looking at cuts, we'll always go to the old one and just check it one last time. And I have to say, quite often, the way the old movie did it was the right way to do it. And we end up emulating that. It is amazing how much you can change and update invisibly. And that's the trick, is that you don't want it to feel like you've imposed yourself upon the film, but instead you want to pull out the best version of the film. And of course, the big change, the big opportunity is casting, because through casting, we can bring another interpretation while still maintaining the spirit and the personality of the old film.
Everything you see exists together in a delicate balance. As king, you need to understand that balance.
Casting starts with being nervous. And especially in the case of this movie, what messages are you sending with each announcement? Yes, we wanted to honor the past, but we also wanted to look forward and do something fresh. And so that's why the first two announcements were Donald Glover playing Simba.
Mercy for what you did.
It was the hyenas. Those revolting scavengers made me do it. I was planning on killing them all.
You fooled the hyenas, just like you fooled me.
And then James Earl Jones coming back as Mufasa.
Simba, come to me. You can do it.
That sounds great from over here. It's perfect.
Mufasa was the one role where, because it was so timeless and the themes that his character dealt with, that anything that we were rewriting or anybody we were picturing as that was not as good as what was there.
You've been warned, Gen Z.
It's been 25 years since the last production. It's still the same guy, but it's a slightly different take on Mufasa.
Dad?
Simba, you must take your place in the circle of life.
Donald Glover, I think, represented somebody who was creative and not just a performer, musical, but still an actor. Also telling the audience that we're gonna bring in a new generation.
I feel very, very connected to Simba's journey.
This is incredible. You're gonna love it here.
When you're recording, you're seeing pictures and like animatics, and you're really breathing life into them.
Timon, Pumbaa, this is Nala.
Best friend? Well, that hurts.
Yeah, my best friend. You know how best friends. Oh, it's like I got many best friends.
Time out. Okay, I need a time out.
Okay.
Let me get this straight. You know her.
Yes.
She knows you.
Yes.
And she wants to eat him. And everyone is okay with this.
Would you calm down? Something? Relax.
Pleasure to meet you, Nala.
It's great. You're playing the music of the conversation, which is nice. And I really think this is a good way to do a lot of this.
You're emoting with all your, you know, with really just your voice.
Ah! You can't win, Scar!
This is my kingdom! My destiny!
That's fun, because you can go as far anywhere as you want, but you know that that's what they're using to really make these characters. Like, if you do it really loud or fast or emote really hard, that's how they'll draw it. So you need to really give it to them vocally so they can capture it.
Simba! You wouldn't kill your only uncle?
No, Scar. I'm not like you.
Oh, Simba. You are truly noble. And I will make it up to you. Just tell me how I can prove myself. Tell me what you want me to do.
Run. Run away, Scar. Run away and never return.
For Lion King,
there was an opportunity to breathe something new into it. And so to have Beyonce, that presence in Nala was able to help us expand what that role meant.
Are you with me, lions?
The movie has an incredible spirit. It opens you up. It talks about the struggle of standing up and fighting for what you love. It's very real. Because the women are, you know, we're the fighters.
We have Alfre Woodard playing Sarabi. She really brings a wonderful texture. Her voice is a wonderful texture.
It's over, Scar. Don't you see that?
Suffering for what? The memory of a life you once knew, a king you once loved?
Still love.
You're adding such dimension to this. Thank you so much.
Sarabi's one of the roles where we found that there was room to add more to. The original was definitely weighted more towards the male roles, and certainly in the culture of a lion's pride, the female lions play a very important role.
We must all stay together and protect the pride lands.
Having such a wonderful actor as Alfre Woodard, who brought gravitas, the feeling of her being royalty and being the queen and being Mufasa's counterpart.
A true king's power is his compassion.
When you act, you have your whole body. With this, of course, you can only do it with your voice. Not just having the tone, but the intention that an actor needs to recreate a human action. Or in this case, a lion action.
Scar, you told us you didn't get to the gorge in time.
That's true.
Then how did you see the look in Mufasa's eyes?
It's magic, you know. It's, some people say it's a craft, but right in that middle part is magic.
We have an imminent threat. Something is approaching. Oh, wait, scratch that. That's my own shadow.
John Oliver. He was born to play Zazu.
Scar, no.
What I liked Zazu when I was a kid, I've always liked a wisecracking bird. And now I am that wisecracking bird.
I had a cousin who thought he was a woodpecker. He slammed his head into trees, and our beaks aren't built for it. He was concussed. Regularly. I got lost in the narrative, sire. Catching up quickly.
Perfect. I think we could move on. You're pretty much nailing it. By the way, gotten compliments on your singing as well from Hans Zimmer.
It's not my first time doing animation, but it's the first time perhaps doing it in this particular way.
As the king's brother, you should have been first in line.
I was first in line. Or don't you remember?
Scar is played by Chiwetel Ejiofor, who is just a wonderful actor who brings a new take on that character.
Mufasa and Simba are gone.
which means I am your king.
Here you have with Chiwetel someone who's doing something different but still evocative of the old version of Scar.
You're nothing compared to me. Nothing compared to your king. Just like your father.
Some of it is slightly newer territory for me in this, and so having somebody who's really very aware of that, very sensitive to it, and can really kind of, you know, just guide you through all the choices and the ranges of it, so you can really sort of find the character and find that performance and find how you kind of tell the story.
I can give you more than one. You see? They think I'm king.
These characters actually take you on extraordinary journeys and emotional journeys and very complicated journeys. And so bringing them back in this way, in a way that can actually be, in some ways, like more relatable, where you can really just sort of fall down the rabbit hole, you know, with these characters in this way, is pretty stunning.
The story is timeless. We heard the story 25 years ago, and we are now here again celebrating the whole story or reliving it again. And we can also do it like 25 years later. It's something that we can always relate to.
It's a very human and honest story of what everything goes through. The point is to be here and to be responsible for each other and, you know, love each other, playing your role, doing what you're supposed to do. Simba's whole journey is really deciding, you know, like, am I gonna face this or am I just gonna run away forever? And him recognizing his father and himself through Rafiki is really what drives him to go back, knowing that it's really about the circle of life and how things work and how we all help each other. It's great, it's really beautiful.
You must remember who you are, the one true king.
We take the weight of things that don't belong to us sometimes, and then we sit in it rather than turning it around. But you keep walking, you keep befriending people that you would never have anything in common with, and that might be the person that, ding, turns, you know, possibility around for you, turns your thought around.
Why haven't you come home? We've really needed you.
You constantly stay true to yourself, and eventually you triumph.
Who are you?
I am Simba,
son of Mufasa.
I think the reason the Lion King has endured the way that it has is because the inspiration that we're getting from it is personal. It's one of those wonderful things where we see the best of ourselves in this movie. I'm so honored to be a part of this event, because it's gonna mean something now to people who were young in their teens and their 20s, who now have children, and now can take their children to learn these same wonderful life lessons.
This is a lesson in redemption. That's what life's all about, making something good out of something bad.
While others search for what they can take, a true king searches for what he can give.
We just had our premiere and just got out of the theater.
Thank you for all coming out. This is the first audience that's ever going to see this film. So
you look out at that theater and you see all those people. I started to get really nervous, but they were all very excited to see it. And it felt like everybody was really engaged with it. And then when the laughs start with Hakuna Matata, then you start to really get a response from the audience. You start to feel the room roll with the movie. And then I just was very proud of everybody. That's what's nice about movies. Being in a full theater like that, it's a communal experience. Movie that's this technical and this big and has a legacy that dates back so many decades and so many people care about, you're one small cog in a big machine. You just want to make sure that everybody who's been contributing feels connected to that thing too, because that's really what it's about. As technical as it is, it's really about people.